He said, why don't you call it exclusion zone, because it excludes, and exclusion zone, EZ. So we call this easy water. And in the xylem, what he did was he infused water and microspheres. And he sent me this and showed me that, hey, look, I want to talk about this one because it's really central, that EZ has negative charge typically. And so the situation looks like this. So if you actually count the number of oxygens and hydrogens in one unit cell, turns out it's not H2O.
What is EZ water? Well, in this video, we're going to get into it. You're here with Jared Pollock and Mark Batwell on Perfect Gardens TV. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe, and check us out on Instagram and Facebook. And if you haven't checked out our membership, for only $2.99, you can have over 115 growers ready and willing to assist you through your growing practices. Let's go ahead and get into the video, guys. Make sure to hit the join button on the bottom of every video.
By some quirk, I met a Japanese scientist at a meeting. We had a nice lunch discussion, and he led me to this kind of experimental approach. And it's actually rather simple. So this is a chamber that you see here, and on one side of the chamber, we put a gel. It could be, for example, like Jell-O or something, but we used a different one. The first one that we used is, I don't remember which one, but anyway, we use many, many gels, and this is just one example. So here's the gel, here's the boundary of the gel out of focus. This is one of our first observations. It's sort of historical. And in the chamber, we added water and particles, and the particles were little spheres called microspheres. So you can imagine a suspension of these, which is here. But we looked in the microscope, and when we looked in the microscope, we could see that there was a region here where these particles were excluded. So if the particles are excluded, we're thinking maybe this is a region between here and here where the water molecules are ordered, just as Gilbert Ling had suggested. Are you with me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it turned out to be more striking than that, because when we watched, and here's a video, we could see that what was
going
on. There's a region here, and the region seems to be pushing out.
Getting stronger.
It just grows with time. And so what you actually see here represents about 3 or 4 minutes worth of movement. So this was our sort of almost literally our first experiment. It may have been our second or third, but we did many such experiments with many different gels, and we found pretty much the same thing. So I was in contact in discussion with a colleague from Australia, and he said, you know, instead of just describing this, why don't you give it a name? So it was a good suggestion. He said the obvious name to give it would be because it excludes. So he said, why don't you call it exclusion zone, because it excludes, and exclusion zone, EZ. So we call this easy water. Okay. It's a different kind of water that exists here.
And, I like the name.
It's easy to remember, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. But the problem is, I like it too. But the problem is, in most countries, it's not Z but Z. So that means Z. if you're in England, for example, it's EZ water, which is not so easy to remember. Okay, so it turns out it's not a great name. It's just so easy, it kind of flows off the tongue. But the primary property is not that it excludes. There's much more that's even more fundamental. And that's why eventually we gave it a name, fourth phase, because everything about it is different from ordinary water. And I'll go into that shortly. Okay, so it's easy water. And I just wanted, since a lot of your people are interested in agriculture and gardens, I presume, by the name, here's an image of a xylem vessel, and this was produced by Martin Canny, the late Martin Canny, who was perhaps the most prominent scientist dealing with vessels in plants and such. And he sent me this. He did an experiment in response to what we had been presenting. And in the xylem, what he did was he infused water and microspheres. And he sent me this and showed me that, hey, look, right here on the edge, on both edges, it seems that the microspheres don't want to go. They're pretty concentrated here, but not concentrated here. And so he suggested that same thing was happening in xylem. That, and now we're doing some experiments of our own. I didn't include here, but we can find the same thing in actually living tissue. And this is prepared by electron microscopy. So,
and xylem, just to be clear, is the veins of the plant, right? It's the tissues of the plant that
the vessels of the plant that take the water that's in the soil, in the roots, and propels the water up. For example, in a tall redwood tree, 300 feet, somehow these vessels manage to propel the water up to the top. And I'll go into that a little bit later about the mechanism by which
have they checked this in the phloem as well? Is there similar results?
I've seen no reports, but the truth is I don't really follow that literature closely.
Does this also happen in your blood, in your cell, like not your cells but your veins in your body? And does the EZ layer around our veins break down as the reason why we get coagulated blood or like plaque and stuff build up?
You're a few steps ahead of me.
Okay. I just like right there with you.
It's true. I'm going to go into that later in this presentation. Absolutely. I'm going to show you about
wow.
the mechanism of flow, and it has applications everywhere.
Wow.
So you'll be seeing that. So, you know, I've been suggesting that this water may actually, this water here where it's organized, the EZ water might be different from ordinary water, what we call bulk water, liquid water. And is there any evidence for that? You know, I've been alluding to the possibility that there might be evidence, but I presented none. So here's a list of evidence that EZ water, EZ water is physically different from ordinary liquid water. It's a list of eight, and it was compiled around 2011. So that's a decade ago. And by now, if I added the additional results, one, because most of it has been published anyway, and also this would use up my time to actually do that one by one. But you can get the idea. For example, EZ is more viscous than liquid water, ordinary water. And this is the technique that we use to look at it, or the molecules are aligned with one another, and polarizing microscopy was used for that, et cetera, et cetera. But I wanna talk about this one because it's really central that EZ has negative charge typically. And we confirmed that by using tiny electrodes actually invented by none other than the same Gilbert Ling, to measure the electrical potential inside the exclusion zone.
And then when you said you said negative charge, is when people reference negative ionic charges and for like plants and stuff like that, is that the same type of negative charge you're talking about here?
It is.
Wow. Indeed. Interesting.
Yeah. In other words, extra electrons. Okay. So. So we did measurements and with these tiny electrodes, and we indeed found that the EZ, typically, not everyone, typically, very typically, has negative charge. And so the situation looks like this. So here is some material, hydrophilic material with charges on the surface. And we start here with water, ordinary liquid water. And over time, I showed you that slide, over time, the easy builds with negative charge. And meanwhile, there are positive charges out here forming a battery. Now, how does that all work? Let me explain with this. So it starts with water molecules. And remember, these water molecules are distributed throughout all of the space to begin with. So what happens is that the energy comes in from outside, and I'll explain what energy that is, and breaks the water molecule. And it breaks it so that there's one hydrogen here, which has a positive charge. And on the other side of the break is a hydrogen and an oxygen, which is minus two usually. So you have a net negative charge here, a net positive charge here. So what happens is that this breaks, and all of these line up adjacent to this surface, layer by layer, forming this. So it's formed out of these components, numerous of these components. And until you wind up with this, and these hydrogen positively charged get kicked out, and they get kicked out and they wind up here in this zone. So it ends up with a negative EZ here and a positive positive charges inside the ordinary liquid water. And therefore it's like a battery. And if you were to stick an electrode here and an electrode here, you could get electrical current, and I'll give you an example of that later, electrical current that could actually do whatever, you know, light a light bulb or what have you. So this is the general scheme. And you can see it differs from what Gilbert Ling found, but the same, the idea is not so different from his idea. And so in somewhat more detail, the EZ structure looks like this. So you have a material, hydrophilic material, and you start with water. And from the water, what is created is the first plane, a second, third. It occurs in layers, and these build one by one, as you see another one here, another, all from the water, starting from the water, turning it into a structure that looks like this. So these are EZ layers. And they form, the material here is kind of a template for the formation from water, ordinary water, to each of these layers, and the layers just keep building. If you were to look at one layer, it would look like this. It has a honeycomb shape, and if you actually count the number of oxygens and hydrogens in one unit cell, turns out it's not H2O. Now, what do you mean it's not H2O? Well, it can't be H2O because H2O is neutral. But the electrode, microelectrode measurements show that this region actually has negative charge, net negative charge. So it can't be H2O. It must be something different. If you do the count in this, it turns out it's H3O2. So easy water, fourth phase water, is H3O2.
Wow.
And it makes sense if you look, because I mean, this comes from the actual count here. But if you had H4O2, it would be double this one, right? H2O times two is H4O2. But that would be neutral. It can't be neutral. And this is not neutral because H4O2 would be neutral. And if you take one of the positive charges from the H and throw it away, you get H3O2. So that's the general structure that we deduced for the EZ or fourth phase water. Now, if you think about cells, and we'll get to them later, this is just a sort of intro. Inside the cells, it's crowded. I mean, this is a gross underestimate of what it looks like. If you look at an electron micrograph, for example, of the inside of a cell, it's absolutely packed with solids. And so the amount of water that's left here is not so much. Essentially, all the water inside the cell is right near the surface of the cell. It's interfacial water, and we would say it's EZ water. And so you'd expect the negative charge next to each one of these. And because it's so crowded, the entire cell should be negatively charged. And indeed, if you stick an electrode into one of these cells and measure the potential difference between the inside and the outside, it's typically minus 50 to minus 100 millivolts. For those people who are familiar with cell biology and physiology and such, they will know that the accepted mechanism for the negative charge inside the cell has something to do with the membrane and membrane pumps and channels and such. Mm-hmm. I wrote a paper to attempt to dispel that notion. I think it has to do with water, but let me not dwell on that particular point.
Just to re-reference what you said, we actually just had an interview with James White, and he showed a video of something what you're showing here on a live video. I'm going to send that clip to you. I think you're going to love what you see.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I wasn't aware of that, but okay, thank you. That's cool.
End of fight. What is an end of fight? End of fight is any microbe, fungus, or bacterium that goes inside tissues of plants. And for example, in grasses, forest grasses or turf grasses like fescue grass or ryegrass,